through Algata, and thank you so much for joining us for another edition of Sports Scene. It's always great to have your company. Now joining me in studio is a new addition to the Sports Scene team, Killa Wanitina. Killa, thank you so much for joining me. How's it going for you?
It's good. It's great. It's exciting to be on board tonight, and I'm looking forward to the rest of the show.
Now, later on, you'll be speaking to Andrew Abel from SAPNG, Surfing PNG. What are some topics we'll be hearing from Andrew?
Surfing is doing a great deal in Papua New Guinea, and Andrew will be here to talk about the surfing policies that they've had so far throughout the country, the upcoming surfing events, the 2020 World Surfers League, which is the one that we'll be looking forward to. So yes, he'll be talking about a lot of great stuff in surfing in Papua New Guinea.
That's great. Now, on the show, we'll also have Moneyball Softball, the Scale Rise Stadium Challenge, some surfing. In fact, Killa just spoke about it. We also have some AFL. We'll be featuring Ace. He's a rising star in AFL. And we have some rugby updates for you. We begin with softball. A new concept of the game was introduced and played in PNG for the first time at the Bisini Softball Diamonds here in Pom. It is called Moneyball Softball.
All teams from the Port Moresby Softball Association Men's Division on show before the all-important battle on the diamonds of the Bisini Sports Precinct. To boost the off-season, instead of the regular matches, the teams receive a tune-up. This brought by a new concept known as Moneyball.
We are pleased that the Port Moresby Softball Association, both men's and women's, have allowed us to take this time, which is normally usually the pre-season of the normal season, and they've given us time to run this tournament.
In Moneyball, the rules are the same, but the match is much shorter in time, with the 7 long innings controlled very much by the players, providing a fast pitch, outfield and more dash between bases.
We have 8 teams with all of them from within Moresby, the Moresby Softball League, with certain players flying from outside of Moresby, like Leh. We've got a player from Leh coming in, several from Medang flying in to play within the clubs here. So it's exciting times for the sport, and especially for this new concept.
More runs secure innings, which ultimately leads to more cash won.
When we're trying to compare both of them, the regular softball we play regular innings without disruptions during the course of the game. However, we play for trophies, and we're tired of playing for trophies. Everyone spend money to come and play the sport and want to take something back. So we've tailored the game to include money. So every inning we'll be playing for money. So every inning won is a money bank into the under the each club. Yeah. So this time round we'll be playing for money. The entire tournament will cost around 9,100 for the round robin games alone, and then we have the grand final, which will be 700 kina, as well as we have some novelty prizes for novelty games.
The Moneyball tournament was run by the Port Moresby Softball Association in conjunction with the Pom Giants Club. Pom Giants Club is a team made up of elite PNG softballers who annually attend local tournaments organized in Canberra, Australia.
So basically we formed this team to identify talent within the country, promoting them as well as creating a pathway for them to go and expose their talents overseas. So we've created that avenue, and we found a competition overseas where the Moneyball tournament is played on a regular basis. So it's very prestigious in terms of quality of softball and the quality of players they have. They have all the national players attending the tournament in Canberra, the Canberra Skins tournament. So we've been privileged so far in attending the tournament for 4 years now.
There are plans of extending the concept in the national championships.
After this tournament, the National Federation might take this up as the new concept going forward to supersede the traditional club championships that usually comes about during the...
Dineros, Moneyball is a very interesting and a new concept that you've taken up.
Yeah, look, Hila. Well, the name says it all, Moneyball Softball. So basically, they play for money. Now, the winning team, over the weekend I checked it out, I actually went there on Saturday, and the winning team takes 50 kina home. And we arrived at around lunchtime when they were playing the grand final, not grand final, they called it home run derby. So that, the highest amount to win from that game is 500 kinas. How cool is that?
Wow.
That was like, so all these players were under pressure, and actually when I was there for the whole hour, no one actually hit the home run.
Wow, so how many innings per game were they making, like 50 bucks?
From what I asked the officials, and they said they had 1 hour, 15 minutes to play, and then they had 3 minutes, and then they have the, they can always declare the game and change over, and the next team bets, and then they challenge to win the game. So that was really cool. And the fact that they're playing for money just made it even more competitive. And the home run derby was just, I was thinking someone was going to win the 500 kina. In fact, I was thinking I should actually join it. If they invite individuals to join the comp, I should join it. That was, 500 kina is a lot of money to win.
A lot of money per game.
Okay, so we'll go for a break now. And on the other side, we'll check out Skelrise Stadium Challenge. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the show. To something a little different, the Skelrise Stadium Challenge on Sunday saw participants flock into the Oil Search National Football Stadium as early as 5 a.m. Let's take a look.
The Skelrise Stadium Challenge, put together by Goodman Fielders, saw about 8,000 participants out there at the Oil Search National Football Stadium on Sunday. This being the second year for this fitness challenge, the concept seems to be taken on well by participants.
I just want to say thank you to everyone for participating in the Skelrise Stadium Challenge. It was great having everyone here.
The challenge itself comprises of laps around the stadium and up and down the stands, and eventually finishing on the field, although that did not even stop children from taking part as well. The participants competed in three categories: the advanced, the intermediate, and the social group. Corporate houses and other groups signed up to participate, and among them were the likes of Cheshire Home. And while winners walk away with some cash prizes, consolation prizes were also up for grabs as well. Goodman Fielders accounts manager Alan Mora-Moro was pleased with the turnout, saying the challenge is growing and there's space for more corporate houses, especially to come on board in the next one.
The turnout's been really good this morning. It's very good to see everyone's very keen and very active for this event. We're very proud of everybody here that has turned up. It's a challenge now to all you other corporates out there and other sporting groups. If you're keen, you know, to make yourself available for the event, it's a great concept, and you know, we know it will grow through the Skelrise brand, promoting sports, health and nutrition.
In this next story, we feature a long-standing member of the PNG basketball fraternity. His name is Moi Mori.
I started basketball back in 1976. I was, you know, that time I was playing rugby, but then somehow I was introduced into basketball with my uncles, just playing fun games in Ohola, when I was introduced into a team called Coleman Bucks. That was 1977. Growing up in the settlement, not knowing the sport, the basketball sport. I was, you know, those days were rugby tarts and all those things, but then not knowing the sport, when I was introduced into basketball, it was new to me. I gave up playing rugby. That was 1982 when I was selected into, because I was playing rugby on the weekends, and basketball was mainly a night game. So I used to go and play night games in the Hola. Then, you know, just because of my build and height, I was selected. They told me I was selected in the, you know, the train on team. Then I left rugby in 1982. I was playing for Mangani Rugby League Club. Then that's where I started playing basketball. That was my first experience, not knowing the game, and I was excited to, you know, go and see some, you know, some plays by, you know, repping, just playing that game. Well, I think these days, because you have a Western underneath the roof. Back those days where all the basketball courts, you can go there and see them there. There's nothing over the roof. Hot sun, rain, when sometimes rain comes, we stop the game. When I got into the game, knowing the game, it was difficult for me to understand the game, know the game. I knew the physics side because I was playing rugby and everything, but to adapt to the new ideas of playing basketball and all those things, it was a new game for me. I made my way up to where I am now by playing basketball, playing this sport. And the place where I grew up, Calgary, was no-go zone. And I didn't want my children to, you know, it still happens today. And my children, I don't want my children to, you know, get into those activities. I want them to, you know, enjoy what I've enjoyed, the privilege that I've enjoyed by walking away from that thing. And now they're, you know, they're role model in the community too, because the kids are growing up, looking at them, seeing them, and you know, if they can do it, we can do it too. So just to get them out from that environment.
I got I dropped out of school in grade 80. And that's where my dad started pushing me to play basketball. In the actual game, like, you play for a country, like, you have everyone behind you. And, like, you feel you have something, you have a weight to carry, and you have to pay for someone that death for your people and your country.
I want them to be like me. If you don't have anything to do, if you're not a scholar, then I think sport can make you become somebody.
We'll go for a break now, and on the other side, Andrew Abel, he's the president for Surfing Association PNG, joins Killer here in the studio. Stay with us.
Good evening, Papua New Guinea, and welcome back to Sports Scene. Joining me in the studio tonight is the president of the Surfing Association of Papua New Guinea, Andy, Andrew Abel. Andrew, thank you for joining me tonight on Sports Scene. It's great to have your company.
Thank you, Kim, for having me.
We want to talk about the surfing culture in Papua New Guinea to this stage.
Well, if you look at the evolution of surfing in Papua New Guinea, it's, you know, we've been around for 30 years now, and but historically, surfing has been around a lot longer than rugby league, in the sense that our traditional custodians along the coastal communities from the Mamase, New Guinea Islands and southern region have been traditionally surfing timber palang boards on cut-out pieces of timber, old canoes, cut-out canoes. So historically, you know, surfing potentially predates surfing in Polynesia before even the Tahitians and the Hawaiians. So there is potential debate now of the evolution of surfing. It probably started in Melanesia before even the Polynesians started it. So it's been going for a long time, and for surfing Papua New Guinea, we have a footprint established in Vanimo, which is the genesis of the whole surfing culture in PNG, where it all started. We have a surf club in Wewak, one in Tapira, North Coast Bogia, Madang, and in New Island, we have two clubs up there. Of course, in Port Moresby, and we're just opening up Bougainville, so we've got quite a wide network nationwide.
Tell us about the sports and how surfing is exposing the untapped regions of Papua New Guinea.
Yeah, so you know, surfing is a sport that's been embraced by nearly 40 million surfers around the world. And in the course of the last 30 years that I've been surfing and developing the whole sport of surf tourism in Papua New Guinea, I've come to realise that Papua New Guinea has some unique features that doesn't exist in the world, and that is that 97% of the landmass of Papua New Guinea, including at 3 nautical mile of our fringing reef, it belongs to our traditional custodians. And hence, what I've been developing is this whole reverse spiral model and driving surfing, surf tourism from the bottom up. Mm. And the four key elements of my model is that underpins the surf management plan is the negotiations, the planning, the implementation management of the surfing resource. And this is not unique only to surfing. It can be applied to any other sector, be it diving, fishing, trekking, bird watching, etc. And this is what's taken me 30 years to develop in partnership with our traditional custodians all around the country.
The surf management plan that you created, as I've read in your website, it's a very inclusive. It encompasses a lot of engagement from the land custodians, and the focus that you give in these plans covers a lot of areas that you briefly mentioned to me that maybe you should talk about that.
Yeah. So the principle behind the whole surf management plan is about empowering our communities. Mm. They're the custodians. They're the gatekeepers. And in my travels around the world surfing, especially in this region, from the Indian Ocean in Bali to Pacific Island nations, our close neighbours, the traditional custodians in all these places that I've travelled are mere beggars and bystanders in their own land. And it's, in my view, it's criminal. It's wrong. And in this instance, for Papua New Guinea, what I've done is essentially taken the whole surfing industry of the world and turned it upside down and driven it from the bottom up. Mm. And thus, by doing so, putting the horse before the cart, so to speak, where the rest of the world have all got it back to front. They've got the cart before the horse. Mm. And they're driving things from the top down rather than bottom up. And so this policy, which is not enshrined in any academic books or in universities or school, I wasn't taught this. It was just a vision that I had, and I came up with the policies to underpin this development of our surfing, surf tourism resource, and that is to engage with our traditional custodians, because mm-hmm. they are the gatekeepers of the resource, and they should participate in every facet of the industry, mm-hmm. In the promotion of surfing and surf tourism in parallel. And that's now become the focus of academics and universities around the world now wanting to learn more about what I've been doing here. But more recently, countries in the region are now wanting to adopt this whole model and policy. In particular, Solomon Islands have approached me, and more recently the countries in Indonesia, in particular Aceh, East Timor, and the Mentawais. Mm. So yeah, it's starting to look like the world is taking note and listening to what we've been doing here in Papua New Guinea to develop our surfing resource.
So also covered in this SMPs is also the Pink Nose Revolution and the No School No Surf. Can you give us a bit more information on that?
Yeah. So in the development of a sport of surfing, we're engaging with community, and it's one thing just to develop the sport and develop the commercial aspect of surfing, which is the surf tourism industry, which is now underpinned by the surf management plan. But we also, as a responsible surfing body, a sporting body, consistent with our preamble to the PNG National Constitution, and that is to focus on the social and economic development of the people in these communities that we engage with. And hence we've come up with what we call the Pink Nose Revolution policy, which is focusing on the empowerment of women with equal rights and opportunities, and addressing gender-based violence. That's our Pink Nose Revolution, where half of our donated boards are painted with a fluorescent pink nose, and those boards are earmarked solely for women, giving them sole exclusive right to those boards. And for our No School, No Surf policy, that's a policy that we've developed for education. And hence, the No School, No Surf implying to the young kids, if you don't go to school, you don't have access to the surfboards. That's the carrot. And we're implementing these policies all around the country, and Bukbalong Pikinini is one of our major sponsors, supports us with our education resource centres in all these surfing communities all around the country. And it's a holistic approach of of not only developing the sport, but these other policies are riding this wave, this momentum of the trickle down effect down into these communities, where in many instances communities have been forgotten. And I truly believe that sporting bodies, not only surfing but rugby and soccer and cricket, netball, all the other sports, have a duty of care and a responsibility to our communities around the country to develop policies that can ensure reticulation of benefits down into these communities, so the children can benefit. And these are the two additional policies that we've developed in parallel with our surf management plan policy. And of course, we all know the history of Bougainville, and that then became the inspiration for me to develop these policies, in particular the surf management plan, driving the whole surf tourism industry from the bottom up to eliminate issues to do with problems with traditional custodians. Mm. That policy has now been proven and tested, going full circle, come back to Bougainville on the invitation of the Speaker of the Bougainville Parliament, Honourable Simon Pintanu, who is the owner-operator of Uruna Bay Retreat in central Bougainville on Pok Pok Island. And in June 2017, I was invited up with our Secretary Sylvia Pasco, and we went up to Bougainville with 50 boards in hand, and we donated all these boards to Pok Pok Island, to Vito, which is central Bougainville, and to Teop Island, which is further north. And then we had an opportunity to present to the full Parliament House in Booker. And I was able to articulate what I've been doing and the policies, and we did a Q&A with the members of Parliament. And since then, we've received the blessing from the political leaders of Bougainville, and we're now implementing our policies on the ground in partnership with the custodians, starting off at Pok Pok Island. And I was just in Bougainville a week ago, and we've established the Surfing Association's what they call the Pirung. Pirung is the management of the sea. It's called the Pirung Surf Management Plan, and that's in partnership with those custodians. And we're very proud to be able to have this opportunity to contribute to the rebuilding of Bougainville through surfing.
Now, surfing is doing an amazing job in rebuilding Papua New Guinea. Now, one of the places that has had the surf culture for a bit now is Wanimo in the Sundown province. From their competitions emerged a young lady who has won the last two competitions held in Wanimo. I like to call her the Wanimo Surf Queen. Let's take a look at her story. Heaven only knows where you've been. From the stunning stretched sandy coastline of Wanimo, an emerging queen in surfing elates the waves of Wanimo's little village. Her name is Samantha Tekwe Wade. A 27-year-old surfer from the Sunset Surf Club, Sundown Province. Samantha, or Semi as she is known on the waters, loves to surf. Since she started surfing, Semi has won two competitions consecutively, earning the title Queen of the Waves.
I started surfing in the year 2000. I like surfing because it is a non-contact sport, and also you feel free, fresh and clean after every session.
While surfing her way to the top, Semi, like any other sportsman and woman, has had her share of challenges.
The huge challenge that I have been facing is the inconsistency of the supply of surfing equipment and accessories, which are only brought up from Australia or being organized by my dad.
On any training day, she spends up to 4 hours given the conditions, that is, the swell of the waves and the wind direction. The surf queen has her sights on the upcoming national selections to be held from the 17th to the 19th October in Taurama, Port Moresby, as she is yet to win a national title. Semi dreams of one day representing Papua New Guinea in an international surfing competition. Grab my hand and we're chasing the train. Yes, and she will be, Samantha Tekwe Wading will be taking part in the upcoming national BSP National Surfing Selections in the nation's capital over the weekend. Tell us a bit about this BSP National Selections.
Yeah, so over the many decades, all our national surfing and selection trials have always been held up north in Vanimo, in Madang, Tapiria, Madang, and of course in Caving, and due to the fact that we have the Oceania Surfing Federation Cup in Samoa next month, we're actually in the southeast season right now, which is the Australian winter swell. So we've had to stage the BSP National Surfing Title and Selection Trials here in Port Moresby because it's Australian winter swell. Up north in Vanimo, Caving, Madang, it's dead flat. The season's in transition. Next month is going to be the swinging of the season, and then the northwest monsoon swell will start hitting the northern region. So that's the reason why this year's BSP National Surfing Titles have been held in Port Moresby for the first time. And we'd like to, you know, shout out to all the viewers out there. If you're interested, to come down and watch this surfing competition on with all our surfing athletes from around the country, you're most welcome. It's on the 19th to the 20th of October down at the Pyramid Board Riders Club, which is on the western side of Taurama Point.
And yes, we're excited for the code and the upcoming events that are set out in the surf calendar.
Thank you very much for having me. Come on.
And for those in the nation's capital, slot into your weekend's plan starting tomorrow to head on down to Taurama to catch some surfing action. It is going to be sensational. Don't go away, grab a cup of coffee and stay tuned as we bring more exciting stories straight after these messages. Welcome back to Sports In. To water sports now, and the Royal Papua Yacht Club, or RPYC, is bracing for exciting events on the calendar this month. This is after a successful hosting of programs, including a week-long school sailing program for sailors in Port Moresby and the nearby Central Province. We spoke to the team at RPYC of the upcoming events, which included the Land and the Sea Race, Three Peaks.
Have our annual Three Peaks event, which is probably the largest race and certainly one of its kind in Papua New Guinea. It comprises of a three-leg race, which starts off at the yacht club to Manuabara. There's a swimming component and a running component up to the peak, and then over to Lolarua, again for a swimming and a running component, and then back to the yacht club and up the gratuitous Burns Peak, where we have the King and Queen of the Mountain, so for fastest times and things like that. So it very much is a unique race which we've hung on to over the years and developed. We've got great sponsors again. There's a number of sponsors such as International Paints, PIH, we've got BNG Trading. Steamships again have jumped on board, thank you very much. Right to Coda services, etc., etc. So very much looking forward to this year's, and True True Warra. I forgot, I haven't got my water in front of me, but and True True Warra. So that's going to be a really good race this year. It's all about the family market, and it's all about getting on the water and having fun. At the Royal Papua Yacht Club, obviously we have a large family market, and a lot of the children don't have exposure to the assets that we actually have here at the club. So it's exciting for us to obviously develop their skills and see them progress further. In future years, obviously, we're looking at things such as having an international race here and events, and furthering their training and development by sending them down to Australia to cross-expose and reciprocate with clubs like the Royal Queensland and Southport Yacht Club, etc. like to diversify a little bit more and press on this training and development next year, again in the sailing division. The boating community at large is alive and well in Papua New Guinea as far as the Royal Papa Yacht Club is concerned, and that's something that we want to obviously again develop next year.
For our programs, we have our own sailing calendar, so we have all the dates that are written in the calendar, so most of the race they all take place during the weekends, most on Sundays.
Setting up something a little bit on a larger scale in Papua New Guinea in 2020-2021. Of course, we have our 100 year anniversary coming up for the Royal Papa Yacht Club in June 2021. And what you'll see is there will be a number of centennial regattas and sailing, etc., etc., during that time and to the lead up to it. So we'd certainly like you there to witness and be involved in that as well.
We'll go for a break now, and on the other side we'll give you some updates of the knockouts for the Rugby World Cup. Stay with us.
And welcome back to the show. To the Rugby World Cup now, and the host nation Japan made history by advancing the knockouts for the first time by taking out Scotland on Sunday. Let's take a look at the rest of the teams who have advanced onto the quarterfinals.
For Japan, the convincing 28-21 victory over Scotland on Sunday meant a quarterfinal appearance and their visitors packing.
The countdown is on. It's there for Japan. The victory is there. And the emotion pours down from the stands here in Yokohama.
Such an emotional game for the Japanese players. Incredible scene.
They now top Pool A with 19 points to their name and are in line to take on South Africa in Tokyo this Sunday.
24 hours, such an emotional game for these Japanese players.
While they still have a giant to face, their entry into quarterfinals marks a milestone for them at this world event.
For Michael Leach, the captain of the Japanese team, history making tonight. The first time you beat Scotland, the first time an Asian team ever makes a cup quarterfinal Rugby World Cup. How does that feel?
I just like to thank everyone that turned up tonight. And you know, it's a tough time at the moment with the typhoon and all, but I'd like to thank everyone that made this game happen. And to everyone that's suffering at the moment with the typhoon, this game was all for you guys.
It just seemed to use that wave of emotion to really use it as inspiration. Did you feel the crowd up there?
The crowd was massive for us, and you know, today it was more than us, just the game for us. You know, there's talks about this game not happening, so I'd just like to thank everyone that made the game happen, and our heart goes out to all the people that are suffering at the moment with the typhoon.
How proud were you of your 23 soldiers out there tonight representing?
I'm incredibly proud. I mean, from the very start, you know, we really played with our heart. Today was nothing about skill. was all about emotion and physicality, and I think we showed that today.
Couldn't send it any better. Good luck for the Cup quarterfinal. Michael Leach, congratulations.
Thank you very much. And we're representing Asia, we're representing Japan, we're representing Tier 2, so we're going to give it everything in the next couple of games.
Greg Laidlaw, I know Brutal still pretty raw, the loss, but that first half, I know it must have been very frustrating. It just seemed you couldn't get your hands on that ball, that first 40.
Oh, listen, first and foremost, credit to Japan because they held the ball really well in the first half. And, disappointing because we ran a few tries. You know, give away 28 points to a quality team like Japan, yeah, you're going to be struggling.
The pace of that game was absolutely extreme. I mean, that second half, both teams are out on their feet. I mean, was fatigue effective you in their second half?
Oh, no, I don't think so. We knew it was going to be a quick game because that's how Japan like to play. So do we. We like to try and keep the ball in. And we gave it a good crack in the second half. As I said, when you lead 28 points, you're always going to be chasing the game.
The thing is, in the second half, when you did put the ball wide, you looked very threatening.
Yeah, we did. We just couldn't do that for sustained parts in the first half. The scrum was a real mess. I'm not too sure what was happening there, but you know that sort of led to the first half for us not being able to get our hands on the ball.
Thanks for talking to us, Cap.
For South Africa to finish off their 2019 pool match against Canada.
South Africa, on the other hand, sending the Canucks home last Tuesday with a massive 66-7 scoreline, is proving to be a force to be reckoned with.
Frans Malherbe was the final one to get over for South Africa. Final score, 66 points to 7. South Africa beat Canada.
And that's something Japan will have to prepare well for.
Awesome.
Samoa couldn't buy their ticket to the quarterfinals as they crumpled under the Irishmen 47-5 on Sunday.
And they're into the Cup quarterfinals in 2019. It's Ireland victorious here against Samoa in their final pool game by a big score of 47 points to 5 here in Fukuoka City.
Ireland now await the daunting task of taking on the All Blacks on Saturday. Meanwhile, Tonga bounced back in the second half to beat USA 31 points to 19 to climb their first win at the RWC 2019 and fourth spot in Pool C.
Two on the board for the captain. 7 points in total for the skip. And it is Tonga.
While Wales finished top of Pool D after beating Uruguay 35-13 and will play France in Sunday's quarterfinal, although they were made to work for it by a determined Uruguayan side.
Still on the Rugby World Cup and Saturday's matches, that's two matches were cancelled by World Rugby on safety grounds. While hosting the Rugby World Cup, Japan is also faced with the worst storm in decades, Typhoon Hagibis. The cities of Tokyo, Yokohama and Toyota areas were predicted to be the impact areas, and so a level 5 evacuation order came out, which meant matches between New Zealand and Italy and France and England were called off. Nonetheless, all four teams were awarded 2 points as per the tournament rules.
After extensive evaluation of the latest detailed weather information, we are today confirming adjustments to this weekend's Rugby World Cup 2019 match schedule as a result of the predicted significant impact of Typhoon Hagibis. This includes, regrettably, the decision to cancel matches on safety grounds.
Yeah, look, it's unfortunate that these four teams didn't get a chance to go out there and actually fight for an actual win, but, you know, on safety grounds, so Japan couldn't risk, even World Rugby couldn't risk putting not only the players, but millions and millions of supporters who would be heading out there to watch those matches. They couldn't put them at risk. Okay. So, you know, those were the high-risk areas, the two stadiums where those four teams were supposedly going to play there. We hope to see the Typhoon, you know, having some mercy on Japan and going away in the next couple of days. But for now, matches will be continuing this weekend. The draws have come out, so let's take a look at the semifinal draws.
away, we have the Kumuls and Orchids Nines teams off to Sydney coming up next. Welcome back. Thanks for staying with us. To the much-anticipated upcoming Rugby League World Nines. And the Kumuls and Orchids Nines teams are off to Sydney, Australia this week, following 2 weeks of training in Port Moresby. The PNG side will be out to play for the pride against the decorated pool of world talent coming from the best leagues in the game. Matches begin tomorrow.
So head to Bankwest Stadium, Sydney, and come cheer us on.
Sydney, what a day.
The Rugby League calendar isn't over. In fact, it's getting more exciting for the League Nations as they play for their country in later October and November. The bookings include test matches and the Downer World Nines. Port Moresby's National Football Stadium has been the gathering place for the best of Kumuls and Orchids Nines teams as they plot victory against the best Rugby League playing nations of the world.
Really excited for what we're going to bring to the Nines, but for myself, I'm very proud and proud for my family, and I'm really thankful for this and the opportunity I get to play for PNG.
Captain is Rhys Martin, so he's probably the most experienced player. He's played a lot more test matches. He's well respected by the group, and he's a leader, so he replaces James Sigaro, who
The girls have been amazing. I mean, like, we've all come from different parts of provinces, and we all have our differences, but I think when we come together, we know we're representing PNG, and you know, we're one, so we have to work together to win. If we don't, then you know, there's no point in being a team.
For the Nines, you know, the concept of it is just open football. You know, we get to showcase the skill that we got over here in PNG, and now, some of the boys in this team have got some great skill and speed and power, and it's going to be, you know, perfect for them in this game. And I'm really excited to see what we can do.
The obvious odds may not favour the PNG men and women folk. From the start, the Kumuls are placed in Pool A with Australia and New Zealand, two of the best teams in the game, while the women are placed with Australia, New Zealand and England in Pool D. But for the only nation on the planet that calls rugby league its national sport, they will play their hearts out for the millions of people back home.
Everyone kind of gets nervous when you get put in a pool like that, because the Australian and New Zealand teams are very high class, and for us, we just got to believe in ourselves. We always, we just kind of second guess ourselves a little bit sometimes, but over the last couple of years we've building a culture where we're very positive and confident going into games, and that's what we have to do coming into this. Nines is different, doesn't matter who you got standing in front of you, you just got to beat them one-on-one really, and I think we'll put a really good performance in against those guys. We've got some really good talent, so we're excited for that.
Stage, our aim is, we're not going there to be a number. We're going there to get a result. It's not the 13th game. Coming off the Broncos game, that was a good area where we measured ourselves, so we're pretty confident going down there. We're not going to hold back. We're going to give it everything we've got, and like I said, we're not going down to be a number. We're going down there to get a result here.
I know, just to give it our all, because I know that we're good enough to play these girls in Australia. They might be big names, but like, they've never heard of us, so they don't know what we're capable of. So,
PNG play their first match tomorrow afternoon in the women's, followed by the men's at 9:25 p.m.
Yeah, look, we wish both teams all the best, all the players. We wish them all the best. They, out there to get experience. Most of them will be out there to, give it their best. And I am sure they will play with their hearts. And it's for pride. They're definitely playing for pride.
Definitely, with the jerseys on and representing our
country.
Right. Yes.
All right. So, Killa, What are some events you're looking forward to this weekend?
This is another exciting weekend for us. We are covering surfing down at Taurama in the nation's capital. Yep. So looking forward to that this weekend.
That's the national selections Andrew was talking about.
The BSP earlier. National selections and trials.
All right. Just a little bit more information. Would you know how many provinces are coming in for this? I know there are 11 associations around the country. So how many of these associations are coming in?
Andy hasn't confirmed on how many associations are coming in, but we're looking at a good number coming in from Vanimore, Tupira, and Kaving. So it's going to be crowded down there. So make your way down there to catch some surfing action.
And Andrew was just mentioning there's going to be a screening at the Arts Theatre.
Yes, a Q&A.
Well.
That's right. A Q&A at Port Moresby Arts Theatre. So it's going to showcase some of the events that he will mention that are upcoming, international events that are upcoming on the surfing calendar in Papua New Guinea. So we're looking forward to that this weekend, yes.
Yeah, and for the other sports, we have softball off-season happening. We have PMSA still out there playing their footy. We have AFL guys still out there for training. They're also looking forward to the national championship, so training's ongoing for them as well.
Yes, and of course the junior basketball continues on this weekend, at Taurama Aquatic Center.
So for all you Palm residents, you can head out to those venues and check out those sporting events. For outside centers, you can always head on to your sporting venues and show support for your teams or for sports in general.
Yes.
Apart from that, let's take a look at what's coming up this weekend. Unfortunately, we've come to the end of the show. If you know of any amazing sports story or any sporting event that you would like us to cover, you can always call us on 312-9200 and ask for any of the sports team, any member of the sporting team or specifically sports scene, and we would be more than happy to call you back. Do leave your contact details. You can always email us as well at sports@emtv.com.pg, or you can always message us on Facebook. That's on our sports scene page. And leave your details as well so we can get back to you. Once again, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I'm Dinero Sraiko.
And I'm Kilawani.
Good night.
Good night.